You know now everybody's worried about that atom bomb. And no one seems worried about the day my Lord shall come. You better set your house in order.
Well, he
may be coming soon.
Well,
and he'll hit like an atom bomb when he comes.
When he comes.
In 1945, the atom bomb became alive. 1949, the USA got very wise. They found that a country across the line had an atom
bomb. Our speaker today is Dr. Robert Darden. He's a professor of journalism and public relations and new media at Baylor University. And his other hat is being the co-founder of the Black Gospel Music Restoration Project. And he is going to tell you all about the efforts that they are making to preserve the musical legacy of Black Gospel music. Among his many honors since he's been at Baylor are the 2011 Cornelia Marshall Smith Outstanding Professor Award, the Baylor University Diversity Award in 2011 as well, and then in 2008, Outstanding Professor for College of Arts and Sciences. He is the former editor for gospel music for Billboard magazine, and you will see his articles in Christianity Today, in on the website On Faith. You'll see them in the Huffington Post, several recently. And he's been doing a lot of press, not only about the project, but about his new book, which was released last October, Nothing But Love in God's Water. And he has some copies of that book available, and he will have them for sale up at the table near the front and be signing books afterwards. So be sure and stop by and check those out. So with that, I will turn the show over to Dr. Robert Darden.
Thank you, Leanna, and thank you for coming out on such a beautiful Saturday. I know it was tempting to stay home and enjoy it. I want to talk for just a few minutes about something that I have been, some people would say, obsessed with, and some people would say in love with, since I was a young boy, and how, in God's timing, it seems that that can be honored. My father was in the Air Force, and as you may know, the Air Force was integrated before the rest of the country. And when my father got promoted in 1960 to captain, we had some extra money for the first time, I understand. I was six. And he went out and bought our first hi-fi player. And he had so much money left over that he bought three LPs to go with it. One of them was a Perry Como album. One of them was a movie themes album, which I can't pronounce. And the other was Mahalia Jackson's Christmas album, with the extraordinary 7.5 minute version of Silent Night, which was, by the way, number one in 19 countries that year, and was only booted out after 2 years in Norway by some group called the Beatles, something, yeah. And my parents say that I listened to that particular disc over and over again. And my wife, Mary, who's accompanied me here, thank you for coming along, because she's heard this before, says that I've spent the last 54 years trying to replicate the thrill that I got from hearing Mahalia Jackson for the first time. So, clearly, I'm white. And yet, this has been the soundtrack of my life all these many decades. And it led to being in and out of the houses of my friends and whose African-American parents are playing gospel music, and it becoming the soundtrack of everything I did and later accomplished. The first concert I ever went to of any kind was Andre Crouch and the Disciples. And I continued to write about and listen to this music all the way through my college years and write about it for different magazines until Billboard magazine asked me in 1984 to become the first gospel music editor of Billboard. Now, growing up as a journalist, I was trained to be objective about everything I did, but getting to interview some of my heroes, like the Mighty Clouds of Joy, or Shirley Caesar, or Albertina Walker, I'm sure I was just a simpering fanboy trying to talk to some of these people who I admired so very much. I left the newspapers, went into freelance, and worked full-time as a freelance writer for years and years. And that's where I wrote many of the books that are on my resume today. And when you're a freelance writer and you only get to eat what you kill, you do on everything. So if you want to know anything about the history of Kentucky Fried Chicken, I'm your man. You want to know about Christians on the NASCAR circuit, I'm your guy. David Koresh and the Branch Davidians, I was there. Any of those books. But they were books that I got to do because I needed to make an income for my family. I continued listening to this music, continued to go to the concerts. In 1999, Baylor asked me to go on tenure track. Baylor, like many universities, I'm sure TCU is not this way, has become obsessed with publications. And they want publications. And I already had 20 by that point, so they were thrilled, I think. And for the first time, I was getting paid at the end of the month, whether I wrote anything or not. And since I wanted to get published and stay there, I finally got to write about, at length, what mattered to me most, which was gospel music. So to get tenure, I ended up writing what later became People Get Ready, A New History of Black Gospel Music, the first book to try to take it from Africa to the present day. And it took me to Fort Worth, in fact, where I interviewed Kirk Franklin and the family for the closing chapters of the book. But something happened during the course of writing that book. I discovered that most of the music I was writing about, I couldn't listen to. It wasn't available. It wasn't available for love or money. I could go to eBay, I could go to Amazon, I could go to used bookstores, and in those days I really couldn't do much else. And discovered by talking to some other collectors that 75% of the music from the golden age of gospel music is lost. It is either in private hands, some of it, or it's in landfills, or it's tied up in litigation, or the small companies were owned by much bigger companies that have no interest in ever releasing this music. Now, why that's significant, besides the obvious cultural and racial bias that entails, is that this is the foundational music of all American popular music. If you want to go back to what, whether you're talking jazz, or ragtime, or rock and roll, or rap, you've got to go back to the spirituals and the work songs of the African Americans. And gospel is the next succession out of that. And I was infuriated. I was just angry, frankly, when I found out to that degree it was gone. So I sat down and in my arrogance wrote an editorial that I sent off to the by God New York Times. And they ran it. Oh, there's People Get Ready. I'm going to get this memorized. Still in print, still being used in many schools as a textbook. There it is. The New York Times, February 15, 2005, ran my op-ed piece that said everything I just told you, but ended up with it. If future generations find out that we allowed this music, this foundational music, to be lost, then it's a sin. They will judge us very harshly for that. When we had the opportunity, I naively believed, to do just that. Well, the next day, as you would imagine, a lot of phone calls, a lot of emails. And one of them was from a gentleman in New York, Mr. Charles Royce. Mr. Royce, multimillionaire, who does a lot of things for charity, said, "Look, I don't know you, and I'm a white Episcopalian. I don't know much about black gospel music. Being Episcopalian, I don't know much about music, period." He says, "You figure out how to save this, and I'll give you the first grant to make that happen." So, being at a university, I knew better than to go to development, because it might end up being in football scholarships. So I instead, what are you nodding for? You must be. I went instead to the libraries, because the libraries are like Switzerland. They serve everybody, and they're at peace with everybody. And I knew they would do what would be the greater good. And I said, "This gentleman wants to help. Here's this free money coming. Help me figure out how we can save this music." So I got their best minds together. And what's great about libraries, and you've probably experienced this, just not only in the public libraries, but in your college libraries, is that librarians are always, their first answer is, yes, let's see how we can do this, rather than, I don't know. That sounds too much work. They always say yes, and that's what they did. They said, here's some things we need to look at. So I told Mr. Royce we had done some preliminary investigations and found out there was a group doing the same thing we were doing, only in Mexican-American music, which, by the way, is equally at risk. And it's the Frontera Collection of UCLA working with the great independent Arhuli Records. And they, on a much smaller basis, was doing what we were wanting to do. So Mr. Royce flew Mary and I out there with another collector, and we spent time with them and came up with the basic plan of what it would take. And came back, the librarians got together and figured out what the best A1 way of putting this all together would look like. State-of-the-art digitization, state-of-the-art sound, new cataloging techniques, computers to hold all of this material, and people to study and serve as an engineer and a cataloger, because it doesn't mean good to save it if people don't know how to access it. And there was no cataloging system, so they created one to put this together. And as you can see, it took some time to pull all that together. But when we presented that proposal, about $350,000 to Mr. Royce, and that included 3 years of employment, my naive, being naive about this, thinking that would probably be enough, he said, yeah. And so the check arrived and we began putting together what became the Black Gospel Music Restoration Project. And in a very short time, because nobody else is doing it, and because this is a project that's easy to explain, this music matters, and for a place like Baylor, which has religious underpinnings, this religious music matters, and Baylor not having the best track record, as many private schools don't, with race relations through the decades and centuries, maybe you need to get behind this. And they did. And the libraries have worked with me from day one to put together what this eventually would be. We ran into problems very quickly. And one is that the copyright is a mess. It's a mess that's been in Congress for years. There's big groups that are working one way and small groups that are working another, and the musicians are working another, to the point that prior to 72, each individual state had its own copyright law. And then if you have a disc, as we did, of a gospel artist, just a regular old 45. We knew the name of the artist, we knew the composer, we knew the record label. We would find out, in some cases, we would have to go through the home state of the composer, the home state of the musician, and the home state of the record label to check on copyright. And it's been a nightmare, as other people who've been trying to do preservation have told us, including the Smithsonian. But we've persevered. And as the music started coming in, and it did come in once word got out, we were blessed very early on in the project to have Terry Gross with Fresh Air do a wonderful piece on it from the New York Times. Everybody, I think, gets why this music matters and why it should be preserved. And the copyright issue, we got around a couple ways. We vowed that we would never sell it commercially unless we had run copyright clearance, and it wasn't our goal to sell it, but for down the road. And so there are companies that you can pay on a per disc basis to run the copyright as far as you can follow those rabbit trails. And if there's everybody is dead and there's no way we can figure out who the heirs are, if for educational purposes, we can make this music available on a limited basis. So since it's a costly process, you can go on iTunes U. Now iTunes, being the great commercial site, has a free site related to it with the letter U for university. And we have downloaded 30 of our favorite songs that we have run the copyright control on and put them up there for free download. And it's now the largest thing on iTunes U for people getting this free music. And it has the little disclaimer written by copyright lawyers for us. Please let us know if you know of somebody who owns some part of this music, and we'll either take it down, we'll compensate you to whatever the current rate is. We'll do whatever you want. Just let us know. And the sad thing is, in the 7 years it's been up, we've not had a single person come forward. So either the people are dead, or the stuff has been swindled from them, which is very common, or they just haven't run across it yet. We are making it available off campus that you can go to our site, and I'll have the website shortly, where you can listen just like Amazon or iTunes, 30 seconds of it. But you can't listen to the entire thing unless you're on campus. Or if you're a scholar and wanting to work on this music, we can write you code to let you have access for free. Because our goal eventually is to let this music be heard. But we can't let it be heard until we save it. So every day, music arrives, particularly after I do some kind of national promotion related to it, a box will arrive. And it's usually what happened is somebody's heard this and says, you know, grandma used to listen to that kind of music and had it on vinyl. I bet she still has it in the attic. And that person goes up and one of two things happens. The first one is the vinyl arrives. This is there. And we'll pay for the shipping, we'll pay for the insurance if you'll send it to us. We'll digitize it and catalog it. Then we'll send you back your vinyl. No cost to you, and we'll make you MP3s of everything. That's the what I hope happens. But more often than not is they get up in the attic and find out that the cousin took it to the landfill 2 weeks ago. I hear that story way too many times. The only story I hear more at Baylor is my dog ate my homework. And that process has been, we're about half of the music, and we have tens of thousands of pieces right now. From the beginning, I don't know how much we've missed, and I don't know how much we'll never get. So I go across the street, we open the box together, it's kind of like Christmas for an old gospel junkie like me. And I won't know every artist I pull out of the box. There are a lot of artists out there, particularly the independent artists who are my favorites, the ones who just record a few, pay a few dollars, and deliver it to friends. Some of my favorite works that way. And you'll hear some of that in a moment. But what scares me is time and time again, I pull out a very beautiful disc, one that's been well loved by a relatively major artist, maybe. And yet I've never heard the record label. Now, I've been in this music a long time. I should know every record label. But that means is there's another whole branch off this tree we don't have any of. And the sad thing is there is no book, definitive book, no definitive catalog of gospel music in existence. We know virtually every jazz song that's ever been recorded. We know virtually every blues song. We know every rock and roll, every rockabilly, every rap, every hokum, every ragtime. And yet we don't know here at the Black Gospel Music Restoration Project whether we have 1%, 10% of the total amount of gospel that's out there. And that means we've lost all that, perhaps. What we're primarily looking for are the black vinyl during gospel music's golden age. Now, the stuff prior to the golden age, which we identify as around 1945 to 1970-ish, the stuff before that, because it is definitely out of copyright, a lot of people have re-released that. And particularly the 78s and before, for you young people, the 78s are the hard ones with the hole in them that go around real fast and stuff. And there's not many gospel artists that were recorded in that era. And there's even fewer that were recorded in the cylinder era. Now, this is museum kind of stuff here. These are the hard wax cylinders about the size of the cardboard part of a... I used to bring them, but they're so fragile you can glare at them and they'll break when you look at them. There's a few groups that were recorded by Edison, the Dinwiddie Colored Quartet, and a few. There's a few more that are recorded on the 78, Sister Rosetta Tharpe, Wings Over Jordan, the Hall Johnson Singers, a couple of the very earliest Mahalia Jacksons. And those are readily available on CD and MP3 now because they're out of copyright and people, particularly in Europe, have been re-releasing those. If you want that, you can probably find it. But because the vinyl is still under contested copyright, that's where we have concentrated our efforts. And what we're looking for are the 45s and 78s and LPs from that era. Every now and then, somebody will uncover a 16-inch, and these are incredibly fragile, partly because they were only made for a one or two-time use. The artist will go into a radio station, have their 15 minutes, and record it and sing, and they might take that to another station for them to play. They're on an aluminum kind of a tray, and they very quickly start separating from the aluminum when the heat gets any different. But we do have some of those and some extraordinary work on that regard. at the very tail end of it, we're starting to get cassettes, and cassettes are one of God's mistakes. That is just the worst format that ever lived. Every time you play a cassette, because it's all that little magnetized nitrous, whatever, iron oxide on it, with that you play from, you lose 7%, 10% of the quality. Every time you stop it, it stretches it. The 78s, cassettes, and the, God forbid, what was the even worse one than that? 8-track players, oh geez. We can digitize those, but they never sound as good as even the older stuff. But we have the equipment now to do that. We have just added in the last few years things to do, particularly related to African-American preaching. We've been trying to start identifying some of the significant black preachers, particularly from the civil rights era all the way back to the 1940s, who have never had their catalogs digitized for us. So we started off with the very wonderful Reverend Clay Evans in Chicago, who was so helpful to Martin Luther King when he was there. The Reverend E.E. Jones in Shreveport, 50 years, head of the president of the National Black Baptist Association. And any other format, if we see that there's a need, we have people willing to step forward and pay for us to get it. Some of them are difficult. Nobody makes the conversion from cassette to digital anymore. There was a company in Germany that did for a while, and we bought one of their used ones because they're not new, and it's broken down twice already. But we'll keep, I'm staying at it. We're going to get all this stuff, particularly from the little Nashboro label, which only listened on cassettes, and they'll have a lot to answer to God for over that someday. The money from Mr. Royce, we took the quietest portion of the library down in the basement, as far away as we could from all the traffic noise. And fortunately, students don't use libraries much, so it's pretty quiet down in that corner, only at exam time when it's full. And we have built up a separate floor. It has its own separate air conditioning, so we don't have that noise, so they don't, it's far enough away from the computers. It's about as close to a silent room as you can get in a university setting. And over a period of months, put together the lab, which has grown and grown and grown as we moved into scanning, because you've got to scan both the front and the back, because valuable information is on the disk itself in addition to the label. It will tell you where etched into it, where it was recorded, which sometimes helpful. Some numbers that we've used, and sometimes because the EQ is different, they've been recorded at different speeds. Put in the very best turntables, which can go at any speed, and go over the roughest CDs, pieces of vinyl in the world. We've had things that have been submerged for decades that we have dried and gotten a really good signal off of. One of the fun things is with the 78s in particular. Now, because in the days of 78s, there was a very small African-American middle class in that era. So these were pretty precious. So if you bought a 78, you were gonna play that thing. So we have received some 78s that look like glass. They've been played and loved because they do us some wear and tear. But what our engineers figured out, and some of the other engineers have not, and why we have so many of these is, as you know, when you make a vinyl of any kind, you etch a groove into the hot vinyl, and it's a V-shaped, and you put the needle in there, and the needle is supposed to stick right in the middle of the V and pick up the signal evenly on both sides. Well, nobody's needle is exactly perpendicular. It biases left or right. So it may be worn down on one side, but the other side's in pretty darn good shape. So we can adjust using a nice big magnifying glass, the needle to tilt the other way, and on something that seems unsalvageable, get a great signal from. And some of my favorite pieces have come that way. That's the turntable that we have over here. This is actually a very small room. All of the computers are somewhere else, all the digitization somewhere else, all of the scanners are somewhere else, everything to make sure we have as perfect a sound as you can get. We clean them using a very old-fashioned type device, but we make sure that we don't touch the label in any way. The scanners have gotten bigger and bigger, so now Baylor is using our scanners to digitize every copy of the student newspaper since the turn of the last century. We paid for that, and for a new scanner from Germany that will scan and digitize and make readable books at the rate of 10,000 pages an hour. So we're doing all of old Baylor's catalog because we wanted it for songbooks, and for instance. And in the end, what we came up looked like this. This is, if you go to our website, you'll be able to search this by artist, song, title, label, soloist. Now we're working on producers, we're working on, it just takes a lot of time to do. You can click on whichever song, image that you want, look at it, blow it up, shrink it, and then play the song for just 30 seconds if you're off campus. Again, because we want to protect the copyright holder. But on campus or with one of our passes, go in and listen to everything you have. And as a result, people have been coming to us saying, yeah, we believe in you, we'll make our stuff available to you. Other universities have, if you'll digitize us and give us a copy back. Some places like the University of Texas, which have extraordinary holdings from several DJs, African-American DJs who worked 50 years, the problem is they can't loan it to us until they have it cataloged, and they have warehouses of uncataloged material. And it just scares me because that stuff's sitting every day and needs to be taken care of. And not much I can do about that. The largest collector in the country is a gentleman named Bob Maravich in Chicago, who has the largest number of 45s in the world. Mr. Maravich is a white gentleman who, at every time there is a funeral or a concert on the south side of Chicago, and there's a photo of it, you can see his little white face in the middle of it, and he's become a dear friend and made great introductions for Mary and I when we were there working on my current book. We are trying to make it faster because you can only do this in real time. So the audio engineer sits there the whole time while it's being played. It's very pleasurable stuff, but he has to do it twice. Once for a archival copy, which is a massive file. That's why we have so many computers, more than 7 dedicated computers off campus alone, and it's backed up each week on tape as well. And then he plays it again for a copy that can be accessible to the public. Well, there's only so many LPs you can do in a day. So we've got, for the easier ones, one of those coming up. We're working with Truett Seminary at Baylor to expand the Black Preaching collection. And then one of the great things that's happened is we were contacted by the National Museum of African American History and Culture, which, as you know, is currently in progress on the Mall in Washington, D.C. And they said, we would like to partner with you so that when, however we set this up, because it's still a work in progress, we would like people to listen to your music from here. So the original plan for the Smithsonian, and we've been up there and they've been down here, is to buy an old African American record store from the south side of Philadelphia and move it intact and set it up inside one of the wings of the building. And then tag somehow, and this is all technical, we have all this wonderful technical stuff and our engineers won't let me touch anything. Don't touch the toys and everything will be fine, Bob. And perhaps a scanner like you see on your iPhone or something where you can listen on your phone to music. Because the old days, you know, with the headphones, those break. There's people who don't wash their hair regularly who use them. All kinds of issues for them. You can't do the big screens that was originally planned because if you're playing one and somebody else plays another on the other side, then it's chaos. And all different ways trying to figure this out. And the new one is, why not use the phones that everybody carries to play whichever the one so nobody else can hear? That's where I understand it is now. Very wisely, they've kept me out of the technical process to this point. You can see the different 45, then an LP, and then one of these 16-inch ones. See, it's hand-typed. That's by the fabulous Golden Bell Gospel something. Stairs. Okay, so the music's coming in. And I get an idea, it's time to do another book because that's what Baylor wants. But I've got something that I've been wanting to do for a long time. While Mary and I were doing research on the previous book, and we would go to African American churches in Birmingham or Chicago or wherever we were, and they would tell stories of the movement days, particularly in Birmingham. And they're extraordinary, thrilling times when you're not only fighting the entrenched racist society in Birmingham, that society has the full weight of the US federal government behind it. And you have, of all the African Americans in Birmingham, less than 10% who actually step forward to support you. Some out of fear, some because they're indifferent, and it's just the way it is on any kind of movement. You're not going to get the great mass of people to ever help. Just a few churches, a few thousand people taking on the world. And as you know, in Birmingham, as in other places, whether we're talking about Selma, or whether we're talking about Baton Rouge, or St. Augustine, or Memphis, they met for the mass meeting, sometimes every night, in different churches, because in Birmingham, the churches have a bad tendency to be bombed, as you know. And if the mass meeting was at 7 o'clock, people would start arriving at 3 or 4 to get a good seat. And they'd start singing. And they sang, and they sang right up until the moment that the program began, which at some black churches, as you know, is a kind of a variable hit-and-miss kind of time anyhow. And somebody would come out and give the plans for the day. I need 100 people arrested at 16th Street Baptist Church at noon. I need 50 young people to try to dart downtown at 1 o'clock. Just the directions. And then Reverend King, Shuttlesworth, Abernathy, or somebody would preach. Usually around, on average, listening to the tapes, about 45 minutes. And some of the most amazing, awe-inspiring sermons that have never been recorded anywhere else, but they're in the Civil Rights Museum there in Birmingham. And then for the other 2 hours, because these things lasted an average of 3 hours, they sang again. So at the most pivotal moment in African American history, they're spending two of their 3 hours in song. Not to mention the 4 hours leading up. And then after it was over, particularly the young people would stay and sing some more. Something is being accomplished with that singing. And it got more and more curious to me to try to quantify what exactly was being done. Certainly, it was being used for recruitment. Certainly, it was being used when times when the dogs and the hoses came out to try to calm the people down so that the young black men didn't go out and bust some heads of their own. And then times when things have been really dark, to lift them up so they'd go out and march again, knowing what was waiting for them out there. They were used for about 8 different reasons that I was able to tease out from all of the hundreds of interviews that we did. Because we talked to gospel singers, pastors, DJs, people who were on the front trenches. We talked to everybody just about the music. And that became the genesis of what would be the two books, Volume 1, which you saw on the first slide, of Nothing But Love and God's Water. And that book takes it from the American Civil War to the Montgomery bus boycott, which is the first place to have the mass meetings nearly every night. So as I'm starting on this book, in the very earliest stages, years ago, the vinyl is coming in, and it's coming in, particularly in the 45s. By big artists and by small artists. And because I'm an old vinyl junkie, I like to look on the front and the back. And on the B side, now there's an A side and a B side, lady. Just for a minute and I'll catch the young ladies up. The B side is the side just for the fans, the A side is for the hits. And that would be the DJ would play if it was for play. And if there were any white listeners in those days, they would be most likely to hear the A or hit side. But the B side, that's where we found civil rights related music that we never knew existed. Hundreds of them. Songs written, not in this kind of double voicedness of the spirituals where you don't know if it's really about trying to get to heaven or trying to get over the Ohio River, but a very overt attack on the institution of racism. Songs like There Ain't No Segregation in Heaven. Songs like I Believe Martin Luther King Is Right. Now you can imagine in Birmingham, where so many people died and so many homes were blown up, just the possession of one of those was dangerous, much less the playing of it. And think about the artist who went in and recorded that. Hopefully all the people in the engineering studio room were black, but not always. And this music is coming and it is giving hope. It is giving some kind of succor to the people who are involved in the movement, even directly or peripherally. So I call my scholar friends who've been doing this material a lot longer than I have, Taylor Branch, David Garrow, two of the best, the King Years, the great Pulitzer Prize trilogy on the King's life. Didn't know that. Nobody knew that because we're getting the 45s that have those B-sides on them. And so what Mary and I realized was this has been a continuum of an unbroken nature, almost apostolic succession. The spirituals, and then when the spirituals, whether the Civil War is over during the horrible years of Reconstruction, and then when the Jim Crow laws take over again, still being sung, and in the 1930s when there's finally some African Americans allowed into the labor movement, and you know labor has a 200 year history of labor song and singing, they very quickly merge, and we have for the first time on the picket lines. And to find this out, you can't go to the standard histories, black or white. You have to go to places like the Daily Worker. You have to go to the communist and socialist newspapers of the day because they're the only ones who are covering black people. And they have articles by people like Upton Sinclair and John Steinbeck on the front lines in Lowell, Massachusetts, or in one of the mills in North Carolina or Flint, Michigan, where the black and white workers are singing together songs that are both spirituals and labor songs. So it's continued there. And as you know, many of Dr. King's earliest advisors have a labor background. Bayard Rustin, who sang spirituals and recorded. And the gentleman in Montgomery and other places. So labor and the movement very quickly link arms. And some of the biggest supporters, besides the sleeping car porters like the packing house workers or the garment workers in New York, give heavily to support the movement. So there's this thing is going on, and it's going on, and it continues. Many of the same songs, the freedom songs, are often, but not always, based on the old spirituals. And it's still doing the same thing. It's still being sung right under the noses of the white overseers who didn't know we're getting this kind of support. One of the songs we found, again, this is, we believe this is the only known copy of it, by a group called the Friendly Four, and I love these names. The Friendly Four, Where's Freedom?
Here's a freedom song for all your freedom fighters out there everywhere. And when you sing, remember the wonderful ones who lost their dedicated lives for this precious purpose and won't be around to see it through. Now sing. Sing, every one of you.
Well, sometime I wonder,
is there freedom in this world?
Sometime I wonder,
is there freedom in this world?
Sometime I wonder,
is there freedom in this world?
This one, this is a tiny label. This may be the only song they ever released. Charleston, South Carolina. Think about recording this in 1968 in Charleston, North Carolina. And yet, if you could hear it, and I get it, I don't know if it's loud enough back, they name-checked the heroes of the movement. Man, that's scary stuff. So, we knew we were on the right track, and Mary and I began the process that began and became nothing but love in God's water. The Smithsonian has shown a particular interest in these songs, as you could guess, as they're working on the different exhibitions they're going to be having. We've started the copyright process on those in particular, because that was something we didn't know. We would love to have some of the labor movement songs that came together, but we have found none of those yet. Nobody ever bothered to record any of these things. Even Pete Seeger, who was there and is one of the great heroes of the movement by continuing to spread the freedom songs, was never at a place for somebody who was recording them. He wrote them down, so we know they exist, but all we have is a few memories and a few oral histories. Here's what the new museum's gonna look like. As you can see, it's something in the shape of a slave ship, and the pictures I have seen in the last week of it, it's gonna be something special. They're not going to duplicate anything that's in the Smithsonian's other exhibitions. They're not gonna move anything over. So the Greenville Woolworth counter that's gonna stay in the Smithsonian, so everything is gonna be fresh and new, with the emphasis on the music on the cultural floor, the third floor. And there. So it brings us pretty much up to date of where we are on this. I am still now going on 10 years later, still preaching this particular gospel, going out and asking people to take the word out with them that if you know somebody that has this music, let us know. We will take care of all the arrangements, make sure there's no expense to you. I don't want to own the vinyl. If they want to donate it and get a write-off, that's fine. But what we want to do is harvest this music while there is still time, to try to put together something that's never been placed together before, to create a chronology. And why I think part of this matters is that through much of this history, African Americans had virtually no access to television, virtually no access to the white newspapers. It was very difficult for an African American to get a book published. There were so many places where their creativity was cut off, except for in music. And both black and white labels released this music, and it contains a history that historians are not able to trace any other way. So forget the value of the music as a transcendent, powerful force. Just as a history, it needs to be saved. And then something remarkable has happened in the last 20 years, and perhaps you've heard it. They were singing the old freedom songs as the Berlin Wall came down. They were singing freedom songs we have on tape at Tiananmen Square. They sang them in the African Spring. They sang them again during the Hong Kong Umbrella Revolution. They're still being sung by countries and nations that are not Christian, that have no African Americans. And yet we have, and if you listen to Al Jazeera or BBC International, which plays the longer footage of these protests, sooner or later, I've got it, somebody breaks into one of the freedom songs. They're not singing them unless they think this matters, that it is doing the same things that it did for African Americans. And my thesis is that this is an apostolic succession. Now, I don't know if any of you have a religious background, or all of you are. But there's a term that certain of the churches, particularly African American churches and the Pentecostal churches in this country, use that I'm hesitant to use in any other context, but I will use the word anointed on some of these songs. They could not survive and still be powerful unless there was something touched to them that makes them cross barriers of race, of nationality, of religion. So it's been my great honor and privilege to continue to hope that this work goes on long after I'm dead, that this work, excuse me, is perhaps been blessed, because I've never taken a penny for it. Baylor, which has many other emphases that they would like to do, like new stadiums where money could go, has continued to support this in such a way that makes me proud of Baylor. And as the music comes in, our audio engineers very rarely, because I never get tired of it, but I do actually have a day job where I'm supposed to be teaching and writing books, call and say, come over. Something has just come through that I think you need to hear. Now, the song I'm going to play next is one of those songs. And the remarkable thing about being here in Fort Worth is the first time this song was ever played was in Fort Worth a few years ago, right after we first heard it, at Trinity Towers, I think you said, the retirement center. Black and white, Christian and Jew. I just heard it that week, quickly burned a CD, talked, and played this song. And the response was such that I went back and tried to find out information about the group. This is the Mighty Wonders, love those names, of Owasco, Maryland. Now, Owasco, Maryland is a little hamlet crossroads on the eastern shore. It barely shows up on Google Maps. But in Owasco, Maryland is headquartered a wonderful, I'm not going to use the word cult, but it's a wonderful survival of people who have continued the traditions of the spirituals singing in unison and later in part harmony. About 200 people still meet together every month and sing in the old way. It's not shape note, it's not jubilee, it's not the spirituals, but it's what you're going to hear. And they're mostly in their 80s. So, what we have found through 7 years of research by running census records and finally a article in the Baltimore Sun 3 weeks ago asking about this, a few of the original members, two of them, are still alive. And they said, yeah, they did this. They didn't remember doing it, but they did it. They had a mobile studio called Mark V, as you'll see, come from Arlington, Virginia, and record them singing this one take in their little church way out in the country, Owasco being the biggest, closest big city to them. And then there's a flip side. And they, as far as we know, we have one of only two copies. The Black Gospel Project has one, and I have one. Let them have that someday. And then one other disc just showed up because of this article. But these are the old, what we call a vanity pressing, where you pay $100, the guy records you, and he gives you 20 copies or something. So it wasn't very many to begin with. Now that's the background. And it's called The Old Ship of Zion by the Mighty Wonders of Owasco, Maryland. Oh, there's the book.
Tis the old ship of Zion. Tis the old ship of Zion. Tis the old ship of Zion. Step on board. Step on board if you want to see Jesus. Just step on board and follow me. There's nothing but love. God's water, nothing but love in God's water, nothing but love in God's water. Step on board. Want to see Jesus, step on board. If you want to see Jesus, just step on board and follow me.
Some of you may remember the Pilgrim Jubilees, similar, but not anything like this version. Now think about this for a minute. Eastern shore of Maryland. During the American Civil War, it was the scene of a number of plantations, and as war came, there are a number of very horrific stories where the slave owners either killed their slaves rather than turn them over, or treated them in such a way that sent them down to Mississippi or Alabama, which for a slave was about as close to hell as you could get. And the blood cries, the land cries out. And during the Civil Rights Movement, some very difficult days for the Civil Rights Movement took place on Eastern Shore, not anywhere near well chronicled as some of the bigger movements, but in Cambridge and some of the cities near Aquasca, there were some atrocities committed against civil rights workers and against the people who dared try to register. And so as best we can tell from talking to the son of John Stewart, who sang that wonderful Sam Cooke kind of lead on that, complete with the lisp, which you can pick up after all these years. This is recorded, he thinks, somewhere around between 68 and 70. And to go into a studio or into your church and sing "There's Nothing But Love in God's Water," black or white, nothing but love, get on board, I'll go with you, black or white, takes an extraordinary bravery and faith to do. And I came out after playing that 5, 6, 7 years ago, and a number of the people, the elderly ladies were singing, were crying after it was over. And at that moment I realized for the first time, and there was what, 200 people at that? It was the largest crowd that had ever heard that music in its entire history. Nobody, probably all told, 200 people had never heard that song as it were heard that day in Fort Worth at the Trinity Terrace. And all but two of them are gone. Now again, I don't know your religion. It's easy for me at Baylor to assume things. But here, if you believe in a cloud of witnesses that the mighty wonders who are not with us anymore for the first time got to hear this song sung for black and white for the first time, and that that music that they so bravely put together is saved. What a gift, what an honor for me to have a tiny part of that. So that's what we do, and that's what I get the great pleasure to do on a daily basis, is to be part of a process that makes sure the music that matters to so many people, that changed the world, and I believe it changed the world because it's still changing the world, because it's still being sung. I heard on BBC International people singing that in the Hong Kong Umbrella Revolution, again. And 100 years from now, it's going to be sung again, I believe. Zora Neale Hurston, the great African-American writer whose work I just adore, talks about High John the Conqueror. Now, High John is the spirit of laughter, a spirit of music, and a spirit of solace for African-Americans. That during the slavery days, whenever old Cuffy got beaten till he could hardly stand, would sit back behind the master's house on a bench, his back bleeding, and would sing, "Nobody knows the trouble I've seen." High John the Conqueror would magically appear by Cuffy and touch him and hold him until Cuffy could say, "Well, Massa got me this time, but there was that time that we outsmarted him," and give him hope once again. Now maybe that's a way of saying the Holy Spirit can touch. And that message goes out like the empire of the air there when it's needed. Zora Neale Hurston compared it to the myth of Arthur in England, King Arthur, that who still waits underneath that hill in Wales for the day of England's greatest need, that he'll come back again. I believe that these songs are always bubbling just under the surface, and that if African Americans or people in Hong Kong or people in East Germany need them again, they'll be able to dip into this well, nothing but love in God's water. And that song will come back when they need it, where they need it, and with the power of the Holy Spirit behind it. Thank you.
You know now everybody's worried about that atom bomb. No one seems worried about the day my Lord shall come. You better set your house.